He said, be of good cheer, it is I. Yeah. Peter, recognizing the voice, wasn't just going by sight. He said, Master, if that's really you, bid me to come out onto the water to be with you. Isn't that great? Too many times we think the people around us are the cause of our bad situation. Isn't that amazing? Too many times we think that the boat that we're in is the cause of our fear. Too many times we think that the storms that are raging around us are the reason for our fear. But if you will tackle the fear that's on the inside of you and get your joy back, that fear will go. The good thing is your joy doesn't have to come in the morning. You can have it now.
That's right. Got that.
So some of y'all are waking up now anyway. Good morning. Be a good cheer. I only preach in E-flat. Now, how close was I to it? It was in the keyboards. But here's what Peter says. If it's you, bid me to come out under the water. Well, Jesus knows it's him. But Peter put a mandate on Jesus. What's he going to say? It's me, but stay in the boat. You're heavy. He didn't say that. He said, somebody with faith. Somebody wants to be with me instead of where they're used to being. Somebody's wanting to come out and meet me instead of wait for me to come to them.
All right.
Somebody's wanting to get out of their boat and their comfort zone instead of waiting, pray me into their comfort zone and in their boat. You're not hearing me. Waiting for me to come and be with them. Waiting for me to come and do something I've already done. We've got somebody that's got enough faith that's wanting to get up out of their comfort zone and come out and meet me where I'm at.
That's right.
But listen to this. He never dealt with fear. You're like, how do you know? I'll show you. Can you have faith and fear at the same time? It's going to help you. Most people teach no, because where there's fear, there can't be faith. Oh, but what about the man who said to Jesus, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. What are you talking about? That means you can have the faith in your heart and the fear messing in your head. I don't know about anybody in here. That's what survival is. Survival is having fear attack your thoughts and you not listening to it even though it's there and rising up in faith and going, I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it sounds like. I don't care what I've been feeling. I don't care what it sounds like. I don't care what you're saying. I don't care what your mama's saying. It's going to be this way because there's faith in my heart besides the fear that's attacking me. But you still got to deal with the seed of fear. You still got to deal with that thing. Because if you don't, it'll lie around waiting for itself to be fed. And I'll show you where Peter fed it. Does it take effort to get out of a boat that 12 disciples are carrying? This isn't a John boat, guys. This ain't a little Fish and Bass Pro boat. This is a real big boat. And I'm talking about a real big man having to get out of a real big boat. Come on, his nickname's The Rock. We've seen him sink before. He hadn't been practicing. Jesus has. Are you hearing me? He hadn't been up in the mountain apart to pray because he is a mountain. It would have winded him to go up there. Are you hearing me? He was a big man, they said. And so Peter cannot be telling me that with his... I don't care if you were 15, 20 pounds. If you got out and tried to walk on the water, which some of us in here have, I don't want to see hands, but some of you have practiced when nobody's been around. You tried to walk on water when nobody was looking. Don't lie. Stop. Look this way. I'm telling you that you know that as soon as you tried to walk on water, you're just like this. You're like, you know, you can't get out any words. You can't get out any phrases. You certainly can't get out the entire phrase that Peter got out where it says, Lord, save me. It would have been, Lord, blah, 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 but that's where he first learned to speak in tongues. Oh. Peter still was dealing with the spirit of fear. Now, I know that goes against traditional teaching, but that's why we haven't been getting results. And sovereignly, God's been giving us results in our erroneous teachings. But thank God, we're getting things. Revelation knowledge is progressive. We're learning more about faith than we knew 20 years ago. We're learning more about the things of God, the Holy Spirit, more than we did 20 years ago. We should. Hallelujah. I believe that the voice of healing era isn't just a time, a revival time. I think it was a precursor to those times that we should be having as common day occurrences and results to this day. So anyway, he gets down. It takes effort to leave his scaredy cat friends. It takes effort to get out of a thing that's still giving you security. But I'm going to tell you, sometimes we're standing on things that are sinking, but it's given us a momentary comfort zone and momentary satisfaction and security, but yet it's still going down. I'm thinking to myself, listen, if Jesus knows how to walk on water, that's the next step I need to know, because my ship is filling up with water. I'm sinking. I got to learn that. I already know how to do this. He gets out of the boat, never having dealt with the fear. Remember, he said, be of good cheer, it is I. He didn't say, ha, ha, ha. He didn't say, woo, glory. He said this, Lord, if, what did we learn last night? If denotes doubt. If that be you. If it's really you. He didn't even think it was him yet to this point, but he thought he recognized the voice. If it be you, bid me to come out onto the water. And he said, come. What does that word do? It gave him faith. Well, did it get rid of his fear? No. Could it have? Yes. How did Jesus tell him to get rid of fear? He already gave him word for that. Be of good cheer. Ha ha ha! Be of good cheer. It will take care of the fear. I appreciate you. I'm so glad you came. Be of good cheer, and we'll take care of the fear. He already had that word, but he didn't act on that word. What word did he act on? The one he wanted to hear. Oh, my God. Which was what? To come out into the water. Doesn't sound like any churches around here, does it? Can't understand why we can't get rid of the fear. We're not doing the word that we hear. We're coming, though, to meetings where we get to hear what we want to hear. That'll give us some power things. That'll give us something to walk on for a little bit, walk through some things. But when it's all said and done, there's still fear down deep inside that hadn't been dealt with. How do we deal with it? He'll tell you. You've got to do it, though. So he crawls down off the boat, starts walking on the water, gets all the way to Jesus. Now, does he have enough faith to walk on the water? Apparently so.
Yes.
Was it enough faith to move him out of the comfort zone and get off the boat? It must have. Was it enough fear to start, enough faith to stand in front of Jesus? You may say, how do you know he was in front of Jesus? I'll show you that in a minute. But he was standing right in front of Jesus, way far away from the boat. Now, you got to understand, when you're walking on the water, oh, this will preach. When you're walking on the water and you stand, you're still immovable when you take a stand in the midst of a storm.
Amen.
But the thing that you've used as your comfort zone, because it has nothing but a surface foundation, will be moved by the storm.
Come on.
The wind, the sea, the waves will toss that thing all around. You will end up losing your mind trying to stabilize a boat when the storm is in control.
Amen. That's right.
But when you get out of the boat and start standing on the true rock of your salvation, and you start standing on the true Word of God, it is firm, it's fixed, it's not going anywhere. When you're standing on that, you can stand in the midst of a storm and not be moved. And I'll say this too, you can also walk through one and on top of one. How do you know? Because Jesus did.
Amen.
Is he our example? And notice this, how come he didn't rebuke the storm? Remember what we saw yesterday? He never rebuked the storm for his sake, it was only for those around him. Because storms had no authority over him. Well, brother, it has authority over me. Well, you can have what you say, but it doesn't have it over me. Look at your neighbor and say, that's you, Wendy. He's talking to you, Wendy. Talking to you, Eve. I mean, Wave. All right, now you. Wouldn't that be cool to meet a dude named Harry Weaver? All right, anyway, so. How do you know he didn't deal with his fear? Because he was too easily distracted. Brother, can I use you? Could you stand right here and be the Lord for us? Peter gets out of the boat. Right there is perfect, my friend. Jesus has beckoned him based on Peter's mandate. He gets out of the boat, gets right up to where Jesus is. How are you going to get this close to the one that gave you the faith to walk through the storm and on it in the first place? How are you going to get this close and start sinking? The reason he started sinking wasn't because he lost faith. It was because he had not dealt with the spirit of fear, that seed. Which was what? Why was he scared? Somebody tell me, why would you be scared on the boat and the wind's blowing around and the sea's getting all crazy and the wind and the rain and everything? What would cause you to have fear? That you're going to sink, you're going to turn over, that this night you will die because of this storm. How come Jesus, who's not in a boat, walking on the water, not having that same fear?
You made the storm. You lightened in the wind. You made it so I'd be afraid of
it. At least she's answering me. Some of y'all are just like too scared to say nothing. Y'all are like... Well, I didn't insist this. Because he's got an idea. He made this and he made that. And he did, woo, where's my organ? He did this, he did that. Yeah, right, listen, we got the middle road preacher here. That's all right. But listen, I got to get Peter out of the water here. He's sunk and he's down there. His bubblers are coming up. So Peter did not deal with the spirit of fear, which is this storm is bigger than me. He was distracted and wanted Jesus, what Jesus had and what he was doing, but he never dealt with back here what he told him to do in the first place, which is what? Be of good cheer. Get your joy back. Don't be afraid. But he gets up here to Jesus, and a lot of times we'll get, it seems like the closer we get, the louder the storm goes. Psst, I'm over here. Psst, I can sink you. I've done this to some of my other friends before. Psst, come here, look at me. And as soon as he took his eyes off of Jesus, the seed of fear began to get fed. Amen. With what? Waves. Wind. Rain. Clouds. Lightning. Storm. The boat is way over there. I did good getting here, but I don't know if I can swim back. And he said, as his faith began to wane, I like to say this, as his fear began to rise, his faith began to sink. And now, like I said before, when you're trying to walk on the water, you know, as well as I do, you go and you try to say, Lord, say, blah, blah, blah. He said, Lord, save me. So we know he was sinking gradually. But what happened? How do you know Jesus was there? Because as soon as he reached down, he raised him back up. He was that close. Thank you, brother. And so here, he wasn't still in the water, and Jesus didn't just leave his head down there, and he's sitting there going, I know. Listen, you little faith, come here. Come, I know you. I know it's getting wet. I know. Listen, get up in the boat. Boom, boom, get up. Boom. You know, he didn't do that. He walked back on the water. Well, how can he do that when fear was the culprit to his faith? Because the seed of faith was still there too. More revelation. Come on now. The seed of fear was there, and because it wasn't dealt with, was demanding to be fed. So faith got put on the back burner. So can you have faith and fear at the same time? You absolutely can. It's just which one are you allowing to be stronger? Now our goal is not to have both. Our goal is to operate in faith. You understand? But he said this. He said, you of little faith, Where did you doubt? Now, with us knowing that story, isn't that funny? You of little faith, where did you doubt? Well, it tells me that the doubt and the little faith go hand in hand. But if you read it on the surface, that's what you'll end up thinking. But the truth isn't that he was doubting, therefore he had little faith, and his faith was big, and now it's not. He was saying, with that one word I gave you, with just the one word I gave you, with the little faith you got from that one word I gave you, you were able to get up out of the boat, walk on the water, all the way to me. And you, with the little faith, why did you doubt then? Right. You started to sink even with your little faith, not because of your little faith, but because the little seed of fear began to get bigger. You of little faith, where did you doubt? He wasn't sitting there saying, I can't believe this. You got this far. What's your problem? He was saying, you got this far with little faith. What could you do with big faith?
Amen.
Anybody getting anything?
Yes.
All right. I see some people are getting a little uncomfortable and leaving, and I don't want to necessarily keep you here all night. But you know what I think's funny? It's how you can think that this isn't more important than anything else right now. And that's why we keep going to the pastor on Monday and on Tuesday mornings and going, Pastor, can you meet with me? Yeah, come to my office. No, you're going to have to come to my house. Stop telling everybody to come to your boat. Get out of that boat. It's sinking anyway. Get up and start walking on water. We don't need a bunch of limping, jacked up, messed up Christians that have been in church 25 years. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, get on it. Come on now. We need to start being armor bearers instead of being barely armed. You know you're preaching bad when all you get is a cord. And it was a major chord too, wasn't it? It wasn't even a minor pentatonic. It was just, and. Go with me to Acts chapter 3, and we're closing with this. Those that had hands laid on them last night, how many of y'all can tell a difference? There was like a hunger that was rekindled. Ooh. How many of y'all been having the Lord talk to you through the day? Thank you, Jesus, for that one lady. Acts 3. Now, I think this is something you're going to like. Now, Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer. We could say this, that the hour of prayer did not dictate yet that they didn't have a prayer life. I believe they did have a prayer life. But I would also say this, that they didn't necessarily say that they prayed yet. They were on their way to pray. Are you following me? Okay, now I do believe they have a prayer life, but I don't think that it's necessarily said that they were already prayed up, but I believe they're on their way to pray. Okay, now, says this, and a certain man, which was lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Now, you got to understand, this man was lame from birth. That means he was handicapped. He couldn't walk. He couldn't rise up. You understand? It was his job to beg. And notice where he wanted to beg. Somebody ought to get excited about this. He wanted to beg at the church. Why? Because of what he saw. He knew church folk were wealthy folk. You know why it got quiet in here? I don't know. I'm asking you. I thought that was good. Give me a major chord, something. The thing is the wealthy folk or the church folk? Why shouldn't that still be the case for the church of the book of Acts today? But it says here that he was laid there, he was carried there. It was okay to recognize him as a beggar because they could look and see his handicap kept him in a position to where he could not do anything other than beg for alms. But what's cool about this is, I'm going to paraphrase this a little bit. He saw Peter and John coming his way. And he had to have seen them with his head up, you understand, because he saw them coming. And he began to stretch forth his hand, begging alms. And I believe somewhere down the line, in his shame, he buried his head after asking alms. Now you may say, why is that? I'll show you here in just a second. Because then Peter and John, after hearing him beg for alms or ask of alms, seeing his head lift, drawn back down, Peter said, look on us. Wasn't he already looking? Something must have changed. Something had to have changed between the time he asked and the waiting for that response. He buried his head. But what did Peter say? Look on us. No, brother, they shouldn't look on us. They should look on the Lord. Where is he? Where is he? Where is he? He is in us. Anytime you want to look out of my eyes, Lord, look out of my eyes. Where is he? Where is he? He's in us. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I am the temple of the Holy Ghost. Where is he? He's in me. Lord, speak out of me anytime you want to say anything. Lord, come on. Look through my eye gates. Speak through my mouth. I am your temple. He said, look on us. Didn't mean we're wanting the glory. He was saying, I'm getting ready to give you something you don't have. He says, silver and gold have I none. But such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Did he get up immediately? The answer is no. Had he gotten up immediately, Peter wouldn't have had to reach down and lift him up manually. That it says, then his ankle bones gained strength. Yes. Yeah. He's like, get up. I don't know how to get up. That's like telling most churches, come on, praise God. They don't know how. Sometimes you got to tell them. You got to say, lift up your hands. Sometimes you got to say, open your mouth. Sometimes you got to say, shut your eyes. Come on. Too many times we're shutting our eyes during the message and keeping them open during praise. Come on. Are we not in one major accord? Come on. Now listen, I don't want to get caught up on the minor details. Bottom line. He said, silver and gold have I none. Did they have money? Sure they had money. What he was saying is this. What you're trying to get from me will only cause you to beg more. But if I can give you what I really have that you really need, you won't have to beg anymore. Because what you want from me is going to keep you in the same position that you've been in. What you want from me is going to keep you in the same position that you were born in. What you want from me is going to keep you all in that state of handicap. And we got too many people that are laying outside the gates. Laying outside the gates, and they're laying outside the gates and can't walk on their own, laying outside the gate and can't rise up, and yet they're seeing the beautiful people in the beautiful houses coming and going, and they're just like, you know what, I ain't one of them, but I'm going to beg anyway, I'm going to do my thing, I'm going to put it, you know what I'm saying, I'm going to get mine. But the thing is, he's saying, you are going to want the thing that's going to keep you in that same position. I've got something that's going to take you to a whole nother position. What I have in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. It wasn't just something where he's saying fancy things. He had an anointing on him. He had a power on him. He had a praise on him. He had the answer because he once was sinking. You're not hearing me. But there was once a time when Peter was walking and he knows what being lame is, to where he's sinking and can't do anything. He was in the water sinking. He couldn't move his legs anymore. He was sinking. But there was somebody that said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have. He said, Lord, then save me. Down and lift him up out of that and caused him to walk on things he couldn't walk on, to walk through things he couldn't walk through, to get into things he'd never been in before. But just when he saw that man at the gate called Beautiful, he's like, now the roles have switched. Now I'm no longer lame. Now I can walk. Now I've got something to cause you to walk. You've been sinking, son, but what I have will cause you to stand up. So what I've got in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And the same big hand that one day reached down and pulled him. done before. Come on. Come on, make my thoughts high. And yet, too many times, can I just be honest in here tonight? No? Because we don't know what we have. We don't think we have anything. I didn't go to Bible school. That's fine. I didn't teach in a Bible school. That's fine. I never pastored. That's fine. What you've got will cause somebody to rise up to the next level. You know how I know? Because every one of us in here have wet feet. Every one of us in here have wet knees. Some of y'all got wet shoulders. I ain't going to go any further. Some of y'all got wet hair, and that ain't Afro-shing. You know what I'm saying? Look at your neighbor and say, wipe your shoulder. I'm telling you right now, you and I both know that we've been there where we were sinking and we needed the help. And the Lord reached down and raised us up. Nobody else could have raised us up. But He did. Somebody said, well, hi, I thought his ankle bones gained strength immediately. Not until that hand reached down and picked him up. Lord, I lift your name on high. How can we not lift up the name of Jesus, who so often has lifted you and I up?
Yeah.
Did anybody get anything tonight? Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Glory to God. You know, revival's not coming. It's here right now. How do you know? Because most people don't come out on a Monday night unless it's somebody that's going to tell them how to have financial peace. Or if there's a marriage seminar. You know, not just another meeting. I'm not going to come out for another meeting. But see, the fact that God has been showing up in these meetings, that's what's odd. Not that He's been showing up, but that's been dealing with the hearts of, like, my brother right there. That engaged couple last night, precious couple, rededicated together. I'm not saying that you were off track. I mean, you just rededicated. You're like, God, I'm not messing with this. Let's do this. How many times do we hear, I'm not going to do that, I ain't going to mess with God, I don't play with God? Yes, you do, because you do it all day long by saying that. I know it doesn't look like it, but you know I'm crazy enough to do it. I may not look like it, but I'm crazy enough to do it. I administer to MS-13s. I've led Crips to the Lord. I've led Bloods to the Lord. I've led the Downtown Boys to the Lord. I've led different ones to the Lord. I mean, just different bangers, you know, Latin Kings. The MS-13, they say that those Latina women are more fearless than the men. They just say that they'll cut you up and just, don't even think about it. Man, you don't want to, they're just real. Dangerous. But I want you to know something. Whenever I ministered to them, it wasn't because I looked like them. It wasn't because I was all tatted up. I'm not judging if you got a tattoo. It wasn't because I was all pierced up. And I'm not judging you if you got piercings. My Lord had piercings. Here, here. Yeah, you'll get that. But what I did have, they didn't have. They didn't realize I was carrying too. I've never gone looking for it. You've got to hear me. I've never gone looking for it. But God said, He said, if you'll talk to them, I'll use you.
Amen.
And this is what I said. If you'll cross our paths, I'll say whatever you want me to say.
Amen.
Never forget when I met this one boy. Shaved head. Good looking kid. Skinny. 23, 24 years old. In a wheelchair outside of a Walmart. And I just felt led to go over and talk to him. Talking about results. And I said to him, I said, brother, can I ask you a question? You know, he's giving me that tough thing, and it may not have been tough. I mean, he's, you know, he was hard. He said, what do you want? I said, isn't that funny? I said, most people always think you want something just because you want to talk to them. I was going to come over and ask you, what do you want? That threw him off. He goes, man, I don't need nothing. I said, yeah, you do. He goes, what are you trying to sell? Nothing. I said, what do you do? He goes, man, I don't do nothing. You know, just hard, just shh. And I said, are you a gang banger? And he pointed to the back of his head. This tattoo went from here down through his shoulders, and it said MS-13 across the back. And he said, I don't bang anymore. He said, I almost lost my life. That's why I'm in this chair. I said, what happened? He said, I was in a drive-by shooting, and I wasn't the target, but I got hit. Wrong place, wrong time, man. You don't know nothing about it. I said, yeah, I do. I said, I've never been in a gang, but I do know what it's like to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. He said, you ever been shot? I said, I've never been shot at. I said, you know, people will pull guns and stuff, but I didn't want to go into church. But I mean, you know, I said, but I've been in the wrong place. I've been in some places. My dad was in the mafia. He was an attorney. I mean, it's just, he was playing both sides of the fence, kind of crazy. But you know, I mean, you find this stuff out later. Every one of us in here has a story. Every one of us. Every one of us. But as I was sitting there talking to him, I said, what happened? He gave the story, tears rolling down his cheeks. And what was odd about this story was he never was crying, his voice never broke, the tears were just coming down like that. And he said, man, like I said, you wouldn't know nothing about that. I said, I bet I could pray, and I bet things would change for you. He goes, man, I already tried that. I said, you tried the wrong thing, because this God does not ever miss it. He said, you do what you want. We started to pray. I started to lead him to the Lord, and then his buddy came out. But he got the prayer out before the buddy messed it up. And he's whacking his eyes and everything. I'm like, God, I just led an MS-13 to the Lord. And I'm alive. I'm not trying to be David Wilkerson. I'm not trying to get my claim to fame by going into gangs and territories. They somehow show up at our meetings. You know why? Because every one of those young men, every one of those young ladies, all want one thing, and that's power. I don't know why I said that, but it's still good anyway. Let's bow our heads for just a moment.